Hey, it's John from Enduring Charm. I was using this tool the other day. It's called a panel carry made by Stanley Company. It's a really useful tool, but it's really inexpensive. And I got thinking about some other tools that I use all the time that are inexpensive, but are just, something I couldn't do without. So this video is going to be about six of those tools that I think everybody should probably own. So this is what I'm going to start with. This is the first one. It's called a Stanley panel carry. And you can see even by the picture here how it's supposed to be used. It basically extends one arm so that you can grasp a 4 foot wide, piece of plywood or whatever. I use this all the time. If I'm bringing up a piece of 3/4 inch plywood up through a finished house, man, I gotta be careful. So this thing allows me to do that. And it has a little area right here to receive the panel and some hooks there. Some people put like a non-slip material here, but I like having the ability to move this along the piece of plywood if I need to adjust my grip. But it's a really handy tool, not expensive at all. And I use this for a lot of other things too. So you can kind of use it as a lever. So the other day I was tiling and I needed to get some backer board and actually plywood underneath an existing radiator. I could lift the radiator up a little bit, but I couldn't hold it there. So I use this as a lever. I slip this area right here underneath the radiator and just pried up a little bit, and it was able to hold the radiator while I slipped plywood underneath the legs. So you could use the same thing. I've used this before on doors when I'm setting a door and I need to just pry it upwards for a little bit while I mark it or whatever. So it's got a lot of different uses, and it's so inexpensive that just using it to carry plywood is a huge, huge deal, and I couldn't do without it. In fact, I think I might get another one now that I'm talking about it. All right, tool number two is the Japanese pull saw. These are also inexpensive, probably 15 bucks maybe. And this is different from an American or English saw in that it cuts on the pull stroke rather than the push stroke. An American or English saw, when you push that saw into the wood, that's when you're making the cut. And when you pull back, you're just getting ready for the next cut. This is the opposite. So when you pull, you're making the cut. When you push, you're just getting ready for the next cut. They're very useful for situations where you have like a delicate molding. For example, when I'm tiling, I often need to cut the stop molding back on an existing doorway, and I can do it with this saw. It's got a very, very thin blade to it. In fact, this one's bent a little bit from banging around the truck so many years. So it allows you to get in close without, damaging other things. This one here is also a pull saw, but it's meant for cutting PVC pipe, which is also a useful thing. And you see the handles on these things are designed for the pull stroke rather than the push stroke. Very, very handy tool, and if you don't have one yet, you should go out and get one for the price that they offer them. Just to give an example of a cut on the pull stroke, this is the Japanese pull saw now. This is a piece of Douglas fir. So it cuts quickly, but it cuts on the pull stroke. All right, the third tool is the pick. And here's three examples. There are many, many examples of this. Some of them have handles, and they have just a pointed, tip on it. Some of them are like a dental pick. This actually literally is a dental pick, and that has a very thin point on it. This is my favorite kind. This is usually called a mechanic's pick, and you'll see it has a 90 degree bend on this side and a pointed end on this side. Now, these are very inexpensive, and what would you use them for? All sorts of things. In plumbing, you'll use these very often to retrieve little pieces of things that drop everywhere, for one thing, but also to remove and put on O-rings on various plumbing fixtures. If you're a mechanic, you'll use this, again, for O-rings and gaskets and things like that, putting them on, taking them off. And it's very, very handy for just retrieving little tiny things that have moved somewhere where they shouldn't, or installing things where you can't get your fingers. So just a very handy tool. You can also use this for marking. So if you have a straight edge or something, you can use this pointed end into wood to mark things, or you can stick it into wood to mark things. So it's just a very handy tool. I often often use this as well for alignment. So if you have a screw hole or something that you're having trouble getting aligned, with something that goes over it, you can stick this end through both holes, get it aligned, and then take it out and put your bolt or screw in. So it's just one of those things where it's something I reach for all the time. And this is my favorite type, as I said, but sometimes having one with a handle is also nice as well. All right, the next tool is something maybe you wouldn't think of. Now, this is an infrared thermometer. And these used to be very expensive, over $100, but now they've come down to $15 or $20. This particular one is Centek, which is actually sold by Harbor Freight. They're all battery operated. They all work basically the same way. You turn it on, and I can select centigrade or Fahrenheit. And then when you hold the trigger down, you'll see that little laser dot. Well, the laser is not measuring anything. That's just pointing to where you are measuring. But the infrared device inside here is measuring. And the accuracy is actually not too bad. It's within a couple degrees usually. But where would you use this? Well, around the house, there's a whole bunch of things you might use it on. Air conditioning and heating, you can measure output in different rooms. If you're checking for insulation and things like that, you can check wall temperature using this. So, if there's one area of the wall that's warm and another area that's cold, that tells you where insulation is lacking. If you have a grill that you're cooking your meat on, well, you can find out where the hot spots are by using this. There's all sorts of weird things like that you might not think of. If you're a mechanic and you're working on your cars, it has a lot of uses. For example, you can check all four brakes after a stop. And if you think one brake is dragging, well, it's going to be higher in temperature than the other brakes. So you can check all your brakes relative to each other and see which one may be dragging. All sorts of uses like that. So this is one of the things I don't reach for that often, but when I do, it's usually something that's, there's no other tool to use. So for the price, it's one of those things I think you should probably have around. All right, the fifth tool is something I could not do without, and that's the blowgun or air gun, they're called. Now, this assumes you have a compressor, and a lot of people do anyway, sometimes just for blowing up tires in the garage or whatever. But a blowgun or air gun basically just connects to your air hose here, and its trigger just blows air. It's as simple as that. And this is the most useful thing. So if you have any tools at all, this is great for blowing out sawdust. At the end of the day, and I do this a lot of times when I'm packing up at the end of a job, I'll just keep my compressor on and use a blowgun to blow out, the motor of the tool and the business end of it, whatever, just to get it all clean. They come in different sizes. This is a little bit shorter one. Some of them have like a rubber tip here. Some of them have a real long tip, but they're so useful. Other things I'll use it for, boy. At the end of a year, usually I'll get all my computers in the home and I'll open up the cover and blow out all the dust out of the computers because the dust builds up in the fans and they start to fail. Great idea. When I'm done using a vacuum after a job, let's say it has a lot of drywall dust in it or something like that, I do use a bag to catch all that, but there's some that gets by usually. So I'll blow out the vacuum and you'll get much better efficiency. If you're a mechanic and you're working on cars, this gets used all the time to blow out dirt from certain areas. You can blow out cooler lines from your transmission or oil lines from your engine to get everything out. So just a really useful tool. And in the shop itself, a lot of times I'm cleaning the table saw, for example, and I'll vacuum out all the dust, but then I'll use this to get the last little bits out of the gearing and things like that. So just a really useful thing to have around. And if you have a compressor, you should certainly have one of these. All right, the last and the sixth tool is the push stick. Now, I could probably think of 12 other tools to include in this video, but I'm going to stop here. So the push stick, they're so cheap. They're like $2 or $3, and they're made of plastic. The whole point is if you're pushing a small workpiece or a workpiece that's close to a blade on a table saw or on a router table, this gives you an extension of your fingers so you don't cut your fingers off. Now, you can make your own push sticks, what I've done a million times, and there's different types you can make. But there's something to be said about these as well. They're very thin and narrow. You can see this one's chewed up because I've actually purposely Sometimes I've had such a narrow piece that I purposely chewed up the chips end of the push stick just so I could get a piece of wood through. And because it's plastic, it takes something like that without, grabbing the blade and spitting back at you. So, just a really useful tool to have around. And for the $2 or $3 that they cost, every time I go to the store, I just buy a bunch of them and have them around. So I keep one at all times by my table saw, by each of my table saws, and one by my router, each of my router tables. So just a really nice thing to have around, and they're so cheap that why wouldn't you get them? Stay safe. So those are six tools that are somewhat unusual, I guess, but they're so inexpensive that I think everybody should probably own them.